Ты мне представиться и прочее.
Представим все. Dear students and colleagues, I would like to announce the second open lecture within the framework of the course on international investment activities. It's my pleasure to welcome our guest lecturer, Dr. Michele Barbieri, an expert in international investment law and practice from Luxembourg. Hi, Michele.
Hi, good afternoon to all. Happy to be here back to chat today.
So we all appreciate greatly that you kindly agreed to be with us to deliver one more lecture, and this time it is capital markets and securitizations. So we are anticipating the interesting lecture as well as good examples. But just a few words in my introductory speech. I'd like to admit that the initiative of meeting today has been supported by the university administration. In addition, the lecture complies with the research under the state program, the title of which is Methodological Foundation and Tools for Improving Innovation and Investment Mechanisms for Ensuring the Socio-Economic Security of the State in the Context of Global Reconfiguration of Foreign Economic Relations. I would like to say a few words about Dr. Barbieri's background in my introductory speech. Dr. Michele Barbieri is currently a director in the Capital Markets Department of Intertrust Group in Luxembourg. Previously, he worked for BNP Paribas Real Estate Investment Management, Deloitte, and PricewaterhouseCoopers. Before starting his career in the financial sector in Luxembourg, he was teaching and a research fellow of international economic law and European law in Milan at Bocconi University and at the Milan State University. He participated in projects of research on international investments sponsored by governmental and intergovernmental organizations, including UNCTAD. He is the author of multiple publications on international investments and economic developments, on sovereign wealth funds, on alternative investment funds, and international taxation. He holds, among others, a PhD in international law and economics from Bocconi University, an MBA with major in finance from EDHEC Business School, and Master of Sciences in International Relations from the Milan State University. Our cooperation with Dr. Barbieri started in 2009. He was invited twice by Belarus State Economic University as a visiting professor to deliver lectures for the students and postgraduates of the Faculty of International Economic Relations. So that was my introductory speech. And now I'm happy to invite Michele to start today's lecture, please.
Thanks a lot for the presentation, for the invitation, of course. And let's start immediately. Today we have another interesting, hopefully, topic. Last time we were discussing mainly about private capital funds. Today we move to public capital. And of course, we will explain in detail in the course of the discussion what this means exactly. So let me share my screen so that we will see together the slides that I prepared, and then we can start.
So, about the sound for students, is it okay? Or a little bit louder? No, it's okay. Louder? No? Okay. So yeah, thank you.
Okay, good. So, okay. This is the quick presentation. I mean, I tried to cover in my presentation, I will try to cover in my presentation the main aspects of capital markets, both equity and debt capital markets. And then I will try to focus on a specific category of capital market operation, that are the securitization, which is something that I think, especially now, I'm practicing quite a lot, because the large majority of my current clients are securitization entities, securitization vehicles. As a usual disclaimer, of course, I'm not talking on behalf of any of my clients. I'm not talking on behalf of my company. I'm just sharing with you some knowledge that I may have gained thanks to my studies and my experience, previous and current. So let's start with some initial definition. I mean, when I was preparing these slides, I was recognizing that these definitions are not particularly easy or intuitive, but I mean, we will have a quick look at them and then we will immediately see what they mean in practice. So public capital markets are public trading venues where sources of funding are exchanges between suppliers of capital, which are usually the investors, and those who demand the capital for use, that usually are companies. And this is essentially the definition that applies to so-called primary markets. And then public capital markets are also the public trading venues where sources of funding to companies are exchanged between different investors. So regarding source of financing, so what are they exactly? When we are talking about public capital markets, source of financing, source of funding mainly consists in securities. Security is a very broad term that covers every financial instrument that is fungible and negotiable. I already said that I will enter in the specific explanation of what this means. Maybe just a few clarification on this definition. When I say, for instance, public, I'm not talking about state-owned or public-owned venues. Public, I mean that they are open to the public. So differently from a private investment, private capital, where the investment opportunities are given only to a few targeted investors, when we're talking about public, we mean that in theory, everyone can have access to these trading venues. Then when I talk about securities, again, financial instruments that are fungible and negotiable. Negotiable in the sense that they can be relatively easily sold and bought on these public capital market. And fungible means that they are, I mean, the securities with certain characteristics, for instance, issued by a specific entity with a certain maturity, etc., they are all fungible in the sense that we can exchange them and they are all the same. Basic example, if I am the owner of some securities, like let's say bonds issued by Italian government with a specific maturity, etc., and other millions, maybe not millions, but thousands of people are owners of the same securities, we can exchange them and the securities that I have with this issuer, with this maturity, are the same as those that all these thousand people have. The securities are divided essentially into categories, debt or equity. Debt, essentially, they are bonds or notes. Equity, they consist in share. As I was saying, I know that this definitory part is not by itself extremely clear. So let's see how in practice primary and secondary capital markets work. So we know that in capital markets, especially primary capital markets, there are two main categories of actors. There are some actors that are investors that they have a surplus of capital in the sense that they don't have the possibility to spend immediately all the capital that they have, and rather than keeping it under the mattress, let's say like this, they try to invest it. On the other side, we have companies that are so entities, person, usually in the meaning of juridical person, that need the capital because, for instance, they need to do investments. Typical example, we have let's suppose a car manufacturer, so a big company, that they need to invest to make investments in fixed assets, so need to buy new machine, new building to make its usual operation. So this company may not have immediately on its own all money needed to buy this building, this machine, etc. So what do? They go to capital markets, and they issue some securities. They can issue bonds, they can issue shares. Investors who have money and want to invest this money to gain a higher return than what they could gain by keeping them in their vault, in their mattress, as we say. So they are happy to subscribe, to buy these securities issued by the companies. And of course, in exchange for these, they pay money. So this is really how work in a very easy way a primary capital markets. So which is, for instance, a stock exchange. So company, in our example, car manufacturer, needing money to make certain investments, then it issues some securities in the primary market. These securities are subscribed and purchased by investors who, of course, pay them with capital. So after this operation, the company has money, has cash, and then it can use this cash to buy the machine, the building, etc., that it was needed. An alternative from capital markets for the company to obtain the money that he needs to buy the building, to buy the machine, would have been, for instance, to go to a bank and ask for a private loan, or to go to a private fund, private investment fund that we were discussing last time. So the company can say, okay, I don't go to the public market by issuing bonds and securities. I would rather prefer to enter into a loan agreement with a bank, a private debt fund, etc., to obtain the same amount of money. Usually the decision of a company to go to private investors, like a private equity fund, private debt funds, banks, or to go to primary markets depend on many considerations. Usually a issuance of securities allows to collect more money, but of course has more costs. And then it keeps the company under more public scrutiny. They have a more reporting obligation. But essentially, you see, there are different ways a company can finance itself. It can look for private capitals, or it can look for public capitals. How? By going to public capital markets, issuing securities. So this is the concept of a primary capital market. Then let's see what is a secondary capital market. And to see it, we have just to think what happens afterward. So again, I repeat myself, company issue securities in exchange of capital. And so we arrive in this situation in which the investors who have subscribed the securities issued by the company, they end up holding these bonds, these shares. So what can they do? Okay, they can keep it in their portfolio, and they will receive dividends in case they subscribe the shares, interest in case they subscribe the bonds. But they could also and should also be able to buy and sell these securities from other investors. And this is why we have the secondary market. So we have the initial investors, so those that purchased the securities issued by the company, that may decide to sell to other investors these securities that they own. And in exchange for this, of course, they obtain capital. And of course, this can happen a lot of time, also many times a day, it really depends on the analysis that different investors makes about the securities. So for instance, if the initial investor thinks that the price of the security that they subscribed is very high at that moment, then it may think, okay, it's a good idea to sell it to another investor so that they can have a good capital gain. The new investor can have the idea, can think that these securities will increase in value over time, so they will be happy to buy them. So this is essentially the notion, the functioning of a market. So primary market, issuance of securities from an entity, a company, to investors. Secondary market, circulation between investors of these same securities. Now, I think we are ready to see how these issuances work in practice in the case, for instance, of multinational companies. So there are many, as you may know, one of the characteristics of a multinational corporation is that they are they have several entities related among them and distributed, spread in different jurisdictions. In our basic example, we have a multinational corporation which has a parent company that is based in Argentina. Then it has three operational companies, so entities that are actually producing something in three different countries. Let's suppose that this company is producing shoes, something basic. So it is producing, for instance, certain kind of shoes in Mexico, but it's also producing leather for these shoes also in Brazil and in Chile. This company may need to raise additional capital to finance its operation. So what does it do? Okay, it has several options. It can go to a bank, for instance, in Mexico, Brazil, and in Chile, asking for loan directly to these operational companies. It can also decide to fund itself by going to the public capital markets. Usually what does it do? It decides to issue bonds in a place where it expects to find many investors interested in subscribing these bonds. It may consider that it can be a good idea to raise capital in Europe. So what do? They decide, okay, I will make an issuance of bonds in a European country so that it will be easier also from a regulatory perspective to have these bonds subscribed by a plurality of EU, European Union based investors. So they decided to set up a company, part of the multinational corporation group, and this company exists only for the purpose of issuing bonds, getting capitals in exchange for these bonds that are issued to European investors. And then these capitals, once they arrive on the bank account of this Luxembourg company, they are sent to some or all operational companies. And in this way, the European investors are happy because by subscribing these bonds, they are investing in debt of operational companies in Brazil and Chile, part of an Argentinian group. These entities are happy because they have access to capitals also from abroad. And so this is the way which, for instance, a multinational corporation can raise all or part of its funding, of its financing. Here I have a quick exercise, not for you, it's more for me, but I mean, we will do it together so that you will understand how this kind of transaction may work in practice. So, okay, here a simplification. OPCO is operational company. So we have OPCO 2 that needs for its operational day-to-day industrial activities to buy machine that cost overall 150 million of USD. And it also needs to buy building that cost 300 million. And it also wants to keep some cash for operating expenses like paying employees of 30 million. Operational company three has similar needing. It needs to buy also some land, which cost this amount, building, and also to keep some cash. So essentially, based on this, we would like to structure the intragroup, the bond issuance and the intragroup financing. So essentially we expect that the needs, financing needs of operational company two and three will be financed by asking a loan to this financing company that is part of the group. And this financing company will get this money. How? By issuing bonds to European investors. So I prepared to make this even more visual. e Quick Excel. So I hope you can see it. I will do it a bit bigger. Can you see this?
Oh.
Yeah. Okay, so.
No. Yes.
Yeah, perfect. So you see, I just copy pasted essentially the amounts that we use. So we saw that OPCO2 needs 150 million to buy the machine, 300 million to buy building, and to keep 30 million. So easily speaking, the total that he needs is this. How will it obtain it? By obtaining a loan from the FinCo. Similar discussion is applicable to OPCO2, so 600 million. And then we know how much the FinCo should raise on the capital markets. That is the money that it needs to pay to OPCO2 and the money that it needs to pay from OPCO3. I guess that here there was a typo from my side, I apologize. And so you see, these are from the uses side perspective of the two loans. And so the sum is this. And this means that this is the amount to be issued in terms of bonds. I don't know if you all or some of you already attended some classes in accounting, but these essentially uses and sources is a simplified pro forma balance sheet exactly of the asset and liability. So essentially a company collects this capital. So these are the sources. So how FinCo receives.
Michele, excuse me. So now we are looking at the picture. This is in the question of the question number four. Right. And as far as I understood, I guess that you also want to show
to share
us
an Excel. It is not visible.
Okay, it is not visible.
Now you're still seeing this, correct?
Что? На что okay, you should find a demonstration, a screen demonstration, and you should, yeah. So,
it's okay. Okay, so it's good that I prepared also the slide. So yeah, essentially what I was saying is that exactly, you have to consider the needs, the financial needs of the various operational companies. So OPCO2 needs 150 million in machine, 300 million in building, and to keep 30 million in cash. So the total is 480. How it gets it? By a loan from the FinCo. OPCO, here it's 3, has this need for cash. So overall, it needs to obtain 600 million, and it will obtain these 600 million by means of a loan from the FinCo. So in terms of uses, the FinCo will need to use money to pay OPCO2 and OPCO3. How does it collect this? By issuing bonds. So you see that this is the simple way of having a cash flow and pro forma balance sheet analysis of this intragroup transaction. So you see, first we have to assess how what are the financial needs of the operational company. Then you assess how you want to finance this operational company. And we said that we will finance them via intragroup loans. So loans given by entities of the same group. And the financing company in turn will be able to provide these loans by issuing bonds to the European investors. So this is really a basic, simplified, but in my view, correct example of how multinational corporation may finance the operation of their companies all over the world by making an issuance of securities, in this case, bonds, on international capital markets. So in this kind of transaction, everyone should be happy because the company in Argentina and the its subsidiaries in other Latin American countries obtain financing, and so they have money to buy machine, building, lands, etc. And the European investors should be happy because they may have a decent rate of return by subscribing the bonds. Okay, so this is again what we discussed. And I mean, this is quite relevant, I think, because if any of you after the, not only after these classes, but when you finish university, will find a job, for instance, in finance, both financial intermediaries and also corporate finance of industries, then you will have to work a lot on these kind of things. So it's, of course, this is very simplified, but the idea is really this one, in the sense that from every perspective, you will need to have sources of finance, source of financing, matching the uses of these financing. And actually, those who may already have some accounting experience know that this is also a way of showing in a simplified balance sheet assets and liabilities. So, for instance, OpCo 2, what are its liabilities? The loan that it owes to FinCo. What are its assets? The machine, the building, and the cash. We can now move to another example of another case in which a company, a multinational corporation, may issue securities again to finance its operation. In this example, in this case, we have financing not by debt, as it was before, but by equity, which means by issuing shares. So in this case, we have the example of a European multinational corporation with a parent company based in the Netherlands and operational companies in Switzerland, Italy, France. Let's suppose that this company is a watchmaker that has a company in Switzerland that is the one that is actually producing the movements that go in the wristwatches. Then the operational company in Italy is producing the leather straps that is that are used with to bring these watches on your wrist. And the company in France is the one that is mainly doing marketing, etc. So this parent company based in the Netherlands wants to raise some capital to finance the operation in Italy and France because, for instance, they want to improve the marketing departments in these two countries. And also they wanted to add some production also in these two countries. What do? They can go to the capital markets and issue shares. So there are investors who can be investors all over the world or in Europe, depending on the prospectus, etc. So parent company issues shares. In exchange, it receives capital. And then when once capital is on the bank account of the parent company, then it use it to provide additional fundings to the company in Italy and France. Again, money can be injected in these two companies in different ways, for instance, with an intragroup loan or by an equity injection, like an increase of share capital. I mean, there are different ways, but it's not so relevant for us to know. You may have appreciated that these are two examples pertains to the primary capital. So in this case, there is the parent company issuing shares to investors and it's a primary capital market operation. In this other case, again, there is the financing company issuing bonds to investors in a primary market operation. Then once these investors hold in their portfolios, these notes, bonds, these shares, what they can do, they can keep it in their portfolio or simply they can go in the secondary market and sell it to other new investors who in turn can sell it to other investors, etc. So it's a very dynamic process. Usually in terms of cost, primary market operations are quite expensive because essentially when a company wants to issue bonds, shares, they really need to comply with a lot of requirements, prepare a lot of legal documentation. They may obtain a specific listing to a stock exchange, for instance. So it's really a complex operation. It costs a lot, it takes a lot of time. So it's not something that a company does every day. So issuance are something that a big company does, not very often. On the contrary, once securities are already issued, then they can be exchanged between actors, between players in capital markets very fast and very easily. I mean, in this case, investors can be really everyone. Investors can be big banks, big insurance companies, or also individuals. For instance, me too, I can quite easily buy and sell shares or bonds with my trading platform. So it's really a matter of a few clicks. So now we have clarified what are, in general, capital markets operation. We have seen the difference between private, primary and secondary capital markets, between debt and equity issuances, how they can be used by multinational corporations to fund themselves. Now I think we are ready to move to the second topic, which that is a specific kind of capital market transaction that is called securitization. Again, I start providing a sort of definition, and then I will provide some specific cases that will make everything very clear to you. So securitization is, as I was saying, a particular kind of capital market transaction, which consists in converting a portfolio of assets into marketable securities. The financial performance of these marketable securities is linked to the performance of the underlying assets. And this kind of operation typically is done for the purpose of raising cash by selling these securities to other investors. Okay, I agree that this definition by itself is nice, but it's not the clearest thing. But here we have this diagram that will explain everything. So there are essentially four key parties in a securitization transaction. There is the initial obligor. Initial obligor is essentially someone that obtains by someone else, who is the originator, some financing, a loan can be. And of course, in exchange for this, it will have an obligation to pay back this loan, this financing. Typical example, a bank that provides a loan to also an individual or a company. So this individual or this company gets some money, but of course it has an obligation to repay it. So in terms of balance sheet of the originator, after it provides some financing, it will hold as an asset some receivable, some loans, which means that he has a right to be paid, usually with some interest, by the initial obligor. If we stop here, it's not a securitization, it's a very general financing operation. The characteristics of the securitization is that, and actually securitization, of course, when the party that provided this financing, this originator, does not keep for itself these loans, but decides to move them to another entity. This entity, this company usually, or a fund, is called a security.
Видимо, интернет упал или что-то произошло. То есть, можно не палочки с интернетом, все прекратилось. Может быть, сам...
И что мы делать будем?
Окей.
So, Michele... we stopped on the explanation. So the relationships from originator moves to securitization vehicle. So please
Yeah, sure.
From this particular point, okay?
Yeah, so, okay, so by recapping, in the beginning, we have just a relation between originator and the initial obligor. Securitization occurs when the originator transfer the loans to the securitization vehicle in exchange, of course, for money. So the securitization vehicle buy the loans in which the originator was the original lender, and in exchange, it provides originator with capital. So at the end of this process, we end up in a situation in which the securitization vehicle holds a portfolio of loans, in which the securitization vehicle is the lender, and the initial obligor is the borrower. And from this relation, the originator is not a party anymore, because the originator has transferred, has assigned these loans to the securitization vehicle, and has received in exchange capital, has received money. So now you may want to know, okay, but the securitization vehicle, how he buy this loan? By issuing debt securities, by issuing notes. So in this way, how it works overall. So investors provide the money to the securitization vehicle, and in exchange for this, they subscribe the debt securities like bonds or notes. With the money received this way, the securitization vehicle will buy from the originator the portfolio of loans that the originator had originated, which means had previously given to the initial obligor. I hope that now it's a bit clearer, but if it is not, I have a couple of examples of securitization, very practical. So you know that, I mean, of course, we all know that a car manufacturer produces and sells cars. Maybe not all of you know that sometime, okay, you can go, we can go to the car manufacturer and just pay the car, and that's all. So if I have, I don't know, my 50K to buy a Mercedes, a car, I go there, I make a check or a bank transfer to the person who is selling the car to me, and it's over. So in this case, we are out of this example, but it may happen that I don't have directly as my personal saving is 50,000 euros, and I still want to buy a 50,000 euros car, and also I have a decent salary. So I can agree with the car manufacturer that they provide some financing to me. So essentially I buy the car, but I don't pay immediately 5,000 euros to the car dealer, but usually an entity part of the group of the car manufacturer provides a financing of 50,000 euros to me. And this company, this entity, provides the same kind of financing to thousands of customers. So after this, we are in a situation in which there are thousands of people who have bought the car, and the group of the car manufacturer who holds in its portfolio all these loans, which this car manufacturer is the lender and the buyer of the cars are the borrower. It can stop like this, but the car manufacturer can also think one thing. It may think, okay, my job is not to provide financing. I'm not a bank, I produce cars. And I don't want to keep in my balance sheet all these loans to individuals who have bought cars from me. How can I get rid from these loans? The answer is, for instance, securitization. So the car manufacturer sets up a securitization company, securitization vehicle, that is usually a completely separate entity, so that its balance sheet is completely separate from the one of the car manufacturer group. And then the car manufacturer assigns or transfer these loans to the securitization vehicle. The securitization vehicle pays a certain amount of money to the car manufacturer to obtain in exchange these loans. So at a certain point, we arrive in a situation in which the car manufacturer have obtained a lot of cash, a lot of liquidity that it may use, for instance, to enhance its operation, to buy a new machine, to buy new equipment, make more research and development, whatever you want. And the creditor, the lender in this car-related financing becomes the securitization vehicle. Of course, you may ask how the securitization vehicle has the money to buy this portfolio of loans. It's simple, by making an issuance of debt securities to a certain number of investors who, of course, pay money, pay capitals in exchange for these debt securities. So, in principle, if the transaction goes well, everyone is happy. Why? Because the individual, like me, can keep on buying cars even if they don't have money immediately available on their bank account. So they don't need to pay immediately 50,000 euros, 80,000 euros, but they will pay 300, 400 euros, maybe a bit more, 700 euros per month. The car manufacturer is happy because they don't have to keep in their balance sheet all these loans with individuals who bought the car. And on the contrary, it may get rid of these loans and get cash immediately. Investors are happy because it's another way of investing money, because essentially the return of the debt securities that they have subscribed is related with some adjustment to the return of the car loans. This means that if, for instance, I have to pay 5% or 10% as an interest per year for my car loan, this means that ultimately the return of the investor will be, depending on the two examples, 5% or 10%. So the investor has the opportunity to gain a financial exposure to a class of assets, which are cars loans, that by themselves, they are not securities, no? Because this is the purpose of a securitization structure and securitization transaction, to transform something that is not a security, in this case, the loan agreement between the buyer and the seller of the car, into a security, a bond or a note. So you see that even though it's quite complicated, it has quite a straightforward rationale, because what indeed you see is that it's a way for manufacturer to free up capital and cash that can be used in other operation. And it's a way for various investors to obtain an exposure to asset classes that normally by themselves cannot be securities. Because I repeat, loans given by a car manufacturer to car buyer are not securities, but thanks to the securitization, they are transformed into securities that can become an investment by specific investors. I would like also to provide you with a second example of securitization. Again, these are just two examples. Securitization can be used with in a lot of cases, but this is really an important, very widespread. So this example of securitization used in connection to non-performing loan investing. What are NPLs, non-performing loans? Are loans that are made to someone who later is struggling to repay. So they are not performing well in terms of financial performance. So let's start with the initial situation in which there is a bank that has lent some money to individuals or companies. The reason can be whatever. So for instance, let's suppose that we have a bank that has lent money to individuals, like me or someone else who wanted to buy an apartment. Unfortunately, these individuals at a certain moment are struggling to repay this loan because, for instance, they are not earning as much as what they were earning when they borrowed the money. So, I mean, for whatever reason, these people, unfortunately, are unable to pay back entirely the loan or to pay every month, for instance, the interest. So what happens? The bank is unhappy, very unhappy, because it is not recovering the loans that it has granted. The individuals also, of course, are not happy because the bank wants maybe to take their home or their personal assets that were used as guarantees. So what is a possible solution? Usually it's a solution for the bank, not for the debtor. But okay, the bank says, okay, I don't want to have this non-performing loan in my portfolio. I fear that I will never fully recover them. So I create an off-balance securitization vehicle and I transfer this loan to the securitization vehicle in exchange for capital. Usually the securitization vehicle will not pay this non-performing loan at face value. So this means that, for instance, if the bank issued, let's say, 1,000 of loans of 10,000 euros each. So we have overall 10 million of loans of face value that has been lent. It will not transfer them in exchange for 10 million because they are really difficult to be recovered. Maybe in some cases, no one will recover anything. So maybe the bank will transfer for just 3 million this portfolio of non-performing loans that in the beginning was worth 10 million. So the bank, of course, will lose a lot because, I mean, it lent 10 million and then it transferred the portfolio of this 10 million worth loan for just 3 million. But at least it obtains 3 million immediately and it has cash immediately that it can use for other things. The securitization vehicle now holds in its portfolio as an asset this portfolio of non-performing loans, and then it tries to recover them. Maybe the securitization vehicle, or better, it's a service provider that we will discuss later, will be relatively efficient in collecting the money that is due, and maybe they manage to collect out of 10 million of face value of the loan, they manage to collect 4 million, which still is good because they bought this portfolio of a non-performing loan with only 3 million. And finally, they managed to recover after some efforts, after some time, 4 million. So it's a very good kind of investment. But you recall from my previous explanation that the securitization vehicle obtained the money to buy the portfolio of non-performing loans. How? By issuing debt securities, by issuing bonds to investors. So in this way, investors obtain, thanks to the securitization, an exposure to a portfolio of non-performing loans. So in principle, you see again, almost everyone in this case is happy because the bank, they has a portfolio of loans that is struggling to recover. So it sells it on discount, but at least it gets some money immediately, some cash immediately. The investors gain an exposure to an asset that by itself is not a security, which are non-performing loans, but which is transformed into investable securities through this securitization operation. So these are two examples of how securitization works in practice, applicable in very widespread cases. So the key idea for securitization purpose and transaction means that it allows investors to gain exposure to a specific asset class, which by itself is not represented by securities, but which are transformed into securities marketable securities by means of this kind of securitization transaction. Of course, also the originator gains from this, because the originator is able to unblock liquidity, because other, without securitization, the originator would have to keep in its balance sheet for all the time that is needed these assets. So again, these are the basic ideas, the basic rationale of securitization. In practice, securitization may be a bit more complex. So essentially what I did here, I took this standard chart, this standard graph, and I added a few elements of complication that shows all the actors that are used in and who intervene in a securitization transaction. I will not, in the interest of time, enter in the detail of everyone, but maybe just a few ideas. I mean, the servicer, what is it? Servicer is a company that provides a quite straightforward kind of service, which consists in fighting to recover the loans. Servicer is present in every securitization transaction, but it is key, especially in this kind of NPL investing operation, because essentially the key reason why the investor may want to participate in this kind of transaction is that they hope that maybe not all, but a part of these non-performing loans will be recovered. So this means that the servicer plays a key role in ensuring that the initial obligor actually pays their debt. Why? How? Sometimes in a not very nice way. For instance, they send very bad letters with legal threats. If you don't pay by this date, we will bring you to tribunal. Then if the obligor keeps without paying, indeed the servicer go to the tribunal. They say, okay, the obligor had to pay. It did not pay, so let's seize his car, his house. So I mean, it's not necessarily the servicer, the nicest person in this transaction, but of course they are there because they are needed, because otherwise investors would not buy loans knowing that maybe they will not be recovered. So this is the role of the servicer. Then we have the security trustee, who is someone who keeps the title, the security on the assets on behalf of the note holders. We have, in some cases of securitization, a sort of foundation or trust that act as a shareholder of the securitization vehicle. This is a quite complex matter. I would not spend too much time explaining it, but as you may have heard before, sometimes the reason to securitize loans resides in the need of removing them from the balance sheet of a company. The best way to remove them is to have them transferred to a company which is not part of the same group of the originator, because otherwise, when you have a consolidated account, consolidated financial statements of the entity, of the parent company of the group, you will still see these loans. So the trick, let's use this term, consists in transferring everything to a securitization vehicle, as we said, but this securitization vehicle should not be part of the same group of the originator. And how this is achieved? Using some specific kind of corporate structures that are, for instance, a foundation under Dutch law or a trust under Irish law that have no shareholders, and they hold the share of the securitization vehicle. In this way, the loans that are in the balance sheet of the securitization vehicle do not appear in the consolidated balance sheet of any other entity, because there is no shareholder on the top of this foundation or trust. And then maybe the last point to discuss today on this introduction of securitization that I would like to mention is the fact that notes are subject to trust. So usually securitization vehicle in practice does not issue just one kind, one category of notes, but different notes. And usually we distinguish these notes in different tranches, tranche A, tranche B, tranche C. And investors can invest in all or only a few of these tranches. Usually each of these tranche has different characteristics because it provides investors with different rights. Usually the first few tranches provides for a higher return, but sorry, lower return, but lower risk. And the, for instance, class C tranches provide the contrary for a higher return and a higher risk. For instance, tranche A may yield only 1% of return, so interest rate, but if the securitization vehicle does not have enough money to pay everyone, they will be paid in priority. Tranche B may provide for a higher interest rate, say 5%, but they are a bit riskier because they will be paid only after tranche A notes payments have been made in their entirety. Tranche C is even more, C is even riskier because they will be paid only after investors in tranche A and tranche B notes have been paid in full. So tranche C is riskier because, I repeat, if the securitization vehicle does not get enough money from the initial obligor, it will pay A, maybe B, but not C. But of course, in exchange for this higher risk, noteholders are remunerated with higher interest rate, let's do 10%. The rule according to which rules of priority, say of subordination of priority, according to which a securitization vehicle pays the interest and the principal to noteholders in tranche A, B, and C is called the waterfall payment. And I have prepared a simplified chart to really show you how it works in practice. So I used, instead of a boring chart, an image taken from hopefully real life. So this is a waterfall of champagne. You know how it works. I know how it works in theory because unfortunately I'm not invited very often in this kind of parties now with this waterfall of champagne, but in practice how it works. Now you have your bottle of champagne, you pour it in the first glass. When the first glass is full, champagne going out fills also the other layer of glasses. When these layers are entirely filled, champagne goes out and it goes also in the other glasses and so on. Of course, if there are not, there is not enough champagne, what happens? Okay, maybe I fill entirely the first glass. Maybe I manage to also to fill these glasses, but already this one will be filled only partially and this one will remain empty. Indeed, the waterfall payments in a securitization vehicle works exactly in the same way. So again, you have the money coming from the obligor to the securitization vehicle. And in this case, this money going from the obligor to the securitization vehicle is represented by this nice bottle of champagne. So money coming into the bottle of champagne. And then how are they distributed to various note holders and various parties? So essentially the first payments which have absolute seniority, absolute priority are those to the tax authority and to cover the expenses of all the service provider. Sorry, let me come back to here. Yeah. So first amount of champagne, or better, first money out of the securitization vehicle goes to pay the service provider. Then, if all service providers, like the trustee, the administrator, etc., if they receive all the money, next step you pay those investors that bought the tranche of notes that pays a lower return but bears lower risk. If there is still money, or champagne in this case, then you can keep on paying those that invested in tranche B notes. If still there is money, because the investment performed very well, then you can also remunerate those who accepted to buy the riskiest tranche, that is the tranche C of notes. So with champagne, we have completed this presentation. I hope that it has been quite interesting. And of course, I'm happy that we still have around half an hour for question and answers on all the topics that you would like to discuss related to this.
Okay, so thank you very much, Michele. Now I'd like to open the floor for discussion for the questions. So about students, if while students are thinking about these questions, let me just ask you maybe two technical questions. When we are talking about a securitization vehicle, so is it usually fund or what is it, or
it should have a legal form for sure. And it can be set up either as a company or as a fund. Personally, I'm, of course, more experienced in Luxembourg securitization vehicles, so governed by Luxembourg law, but there are securitization law also in many other countries. There is a European regulation covering a securitization vehicle. In most cases, it's set up as a company, as a capital company, like an open joint stock company or a private limited liability company.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and the second question. So when the securitization is transfer of assets and loans into securities, is it usually the security of debt nature? So debt security or equity security?
In most cases, they are debt securities. So they are called notes or bonds, because the idea is that they pay an interest rate that is somehow related to the interest rate of the underlying obligation. So essentially, the investor buys obligation notes from the securitization vehicle, which will yield an interest rate that is connected to the interest rate paid under the original loan agreement now in force between the initial obligor and the securitization vehicle. So technically, it's possible for a securitization vehicle also to issue securities other than debt securities, but in practice, the securitization vehicle issues debt securities. And if, for instance, you see the balance sheet and obviously not the balance sheet, the profit and loss account of a securitization vehicle, essentially it is zero, because the securitization vehicle receives as an income the interest from the initial obligor, but then it uses this income first to pay all the expenses that it may incur, and after this it pays interest on all the notes that it has issued. So at the end, the profit of a securitization vehicle should always equal zero.
Okay. So the questions from students, from graduates, master students.
I can.
So our master student, Sergey.
Yes. Mr. Barbieri, I would like to ask such interesting question that if we are going to remember 2008, there was a financial crisis. And my question is just simple. We know that some companies can raise their money or get some savings for special projects and then loss. And this question, the economy starts to accrue this loss and obligatories, and that's my question. What is the limit of these obligations where you need to, when a government need to get regulated to capital market or something do not to get into the another financial crisis?
Yeah, no, thanks for the question, because indeed, I mean, here I'm talking, I think, quite in a positive way about securitization, but unfortunately, it happened in some cases, like exactly on the occasion of the financial crisis of 2007, 2008, that indeed securitization was not used in the best way, especially in the United States. And then the result was a big mess in financial markets, which later translated into this big financial crisis. The main reason of this, in my view, and in the view of also economists much more experienced than me, is that on that occasion, securitization became very complex and very uncontrolled, because in my example now, we see that essentially the originator just transfer its receivable to the securitization vehicle, and then they are transformed in securities for investors. What was happening at the time, and may still happen today, is that the process was not of securitization was not stopping at this level, I mean, between securitization vehicle and investors, but usually many debt securities were bought by other securitization vehicles, which bought, bought notes from various securitization vehicles and issued in turn notes that were purchased by other securitization vehicles. So at the end, we had securitization of securitization or repackaging. And the result was that at the end, no one actually knew what a securitization vehicle had in its portfolio and to which kind of financial assets it was exposed. Because you know that, I mean, if you have just one step securitization, in this case, okay, as an investor, you know well to which you acquired financial exposure. On the contrary, if, let's suppose, this securitization vehicle notes are bought by other securitization vehicle, which issue notes that are bought by other securitization vehicle, at the end, no one knows what is the final exposure. And indeed, this was exactly what was happening at the time of the big financial crisis of 2008, that essentially banks were originating loans without paying attention at all to the quality of the borrower. Why? Because they knew that in any case, they would have sold these loans to someone else. So even if the borrower was not likely to pay, no one cared, because the bank said, okay, I will just originate the loan, then I will get rid of this note, this loan, and I will not think about it anymore. The securitization vehicle was receiving these loans, but then it was securitizing and someone else was buying the debt securities, and this someone else was another securitization vehicle. So ultimately, investors were buying these securities that had a very unclear exposure to the final underlying assets. And for a few years, this worked quite well. Everyone was happy, money was moving around very fast. At a certain moment, when the price of the real estate in the US started going down, it was clear that somehow the underlying investment was not safe anymore. And so everyone in this big game, decided to not to trust anymore the securities that they bought from a securities issue vehicle. And out of this confusion, no one was suddenly willing, no bank, etc., willing to trade anymore with this kind of securities. And this caused a freezing of the credit markets, which later evolved in the big financial crisis. So indeed, this discussion that we are having today on securitization, and especially on securitization and re-securitization or repackaging of non-performing loan, is one of the explanation of the big 2008 financial crisis. And it is also one of the explanation of the current regulation, for instance, at European level of securitization, because, for instance, now the European securitization regulation that was drafted in 2017, for instance, prevents from doing securitization of securitization. So this means that once a securitization vehicle receives certain assets and issue debt securities related to them, then the investor cannot be in turn another securitization vehicle to repackage, to re-securitize these. So this is one of the approach that the European institution adopted when regulating a securitization vehicle to reduce a bit the risk related to securitization of securitization. Another key element of the European Union framework governing securitization, which objective is indeed to mitigate this risk, is the so-called retention rule. This means that the originator cannot completely delete its exposure to the underlying investment, but it needs to subscribe at least 5% of the notes issued by the securitization vehicle. This should reduce a bit the risk that the originator grant loans to everyone without caring about the quality of these loans, but on the contrary, will take care of not granting reckless loans, because at the end, he will keep a small exposure to them. So if the originator grants loans without control, without diligence, etc., still, even with securitization, it may suffer losses, because still it will gain an exposure to these underlying assets. And if I may just add one thing also for students, there is a nice movie of a few years ago, which is called The Big Short. And it really talks about how a few smart guys made money by betting on the fall of the real estate market in Luxembourg. And this movie also talks about this kind of securitization and re-securitization of mortgage loan in the United States. So it's a kind of new movie that I think people can enjoy if they have some background like the one that we're getting with this lecture today.
Okay, thank you very much. What about students? What about ideas? So to ask questions. Okay, please.
Okay, thank you for the lecture. And my question is, if I heard correctly, the securitization company can be founded by the company which is provide initial loan. And my question is for the company, isn't it much more difficult to set up a new company? And what happens after the securitization process with this securitization company?
Yeah, okay. So essentially, once the securitization company is set up, then it will continue to exist for all the time in which the notes are outstanding and they are subscribed by investors. So essentially, after the so this is the case of the securitization of a portfolio of non-performing loans. So after this launch of the securitization transaction, the securitization vehicle will keep on existing, and it will keep on receiving money from the obligors by way of interests and repayment of the principal under the non-performing loans. And with the money received this way, the securitization vehicle will continue to make payments to the trustee, the service provider, etc., and to the note holders. So in principle, the securitization transaction is over, and the securitization vehicle, that is a company, can be liquidated when the portfolio of non-performing loan is repaid or somehow recovered, and all the debt securities that have been subscribed by investor are prepaid or redeemed. So usually this takes various years. So usually, yeah, the time horizon of a securitization vehicle is a few years. And when the securitization is over, we don't have interest anymore to keep this securitization vehicle. It is a company existing, so it is simply put in liquidation. And usually, exactly, and this is of course related with the maturity of the portfolio of the underlying investment and the maturity of the debt securities that are issued. Then it's possible that there are multiple origination and multiple issuances of notes. So this means that the same securitization vehicle may acquire, let's say, every 6 months a portfolio of assets, of receivable, and every month it issues new notes that are subscribed again by investors. So so we can have just a one-off securitization or a multiple securitization, part of a single securitization program, which can continue for several years. But yeah, usually a securitization transaction is something that lasts a few years because, to launch it, it costs a lot because, this chart gives a bit more the idea, but there are really a lot of legal documentation that are prepared by lawyers, and really to launch a securitization may cost just in fees hundreds of thousands of euros. So I mean, if you pay lawyers that has to draft hundreds of pages, all the service provider that participate in this, so usually you don't do a securitization very often. You do it just a few times from a company perspective, and you make it last quite a lot and for relevant amounts. So you would not set up a securitization for a few millions of euros, because once a securitization transaction costs in various fees hundreds of thousands of euros, then you would not use these to securitize a portfolio of 20 million of loans. You would use it to securitize a portfolio of hundreds of millions.
So thank you very much. Any more questions? If not, I just want to ask you from the global economy point of view, what are the main trends in securitization nowadays? In terms of maybe, so the securitizations are more concentrated in particular industries or in particular geographical points. And what are the main problems?
Yeah. So essentially, securitization is a business that is, I would say, going very well. There was a partial slowdown in the aftermath of the big financial crisis, because indeed securitization was considered as one of the causes of the financial crisis. But since then, securitization transaction came back to fashion, because if they are done with a minimum of responsibility, with a minimum of organization and the rules, they can be beneficial for the real economy. because essentially they are very useful for investors to obtain financial exposure to new asset classes, and for companies to free up capitals that may be used to finance other operations. So regarding the first point, the appetite for investors in securitization, I think it's quite related with something that we discussed also on the occasion of my previous conference, when we were talking about the abundance of liquidity, especially in countries, in places like the EU or UK or the United States. And this abundance of liquidity has contributed to keep the usual returns of more traditional asset classes low. So investors, especially institutional investors, are really looking for everything to try to have good returns. And indeed, securitization may be very useful to obtain a financial exposure to asset classes that normally are not financial products. So this is the first reason why there will be in the foreseeable future interest and appetite from investor side about securitization. And then it's a very good system for companies, for industries to obtain financing. So I provided today the two examples of securitization for non-performing loans and also for car manufacturers. But we have very similar cases of these in every kind of industry. So for instance, industrial groups that sell a good service and is not paid immediately, but as a receivable against the customer. And rather than keeping this receivable in their balance sheet, they transfer it to the securitization vehicle so that they have immediate access to cash. So indeed, securitization are very good for companies to improve their liquidity, to free up cash that they can use for any other operation. So these are, in my view, the two drivers for securitization, which explain why securitization are, is going to be very important also in the foreseeable future. Then also to draw a sort of connection between what we discussed today and what we discussed last time about funds, securitization may also be used in a connection to investment funds. So it's possible that an investment fund, for many reasons, cannot invest directly in private debt. So it can set up a securitization vehicle, which purchases the debt, and it issues securities that are subscribed by an investment fund, which in turn has its own investors. So a recent trend that they have seen in the market is indeed also to see securitization vehicles used as a platform for investment funds, private capital funds. So you see this mix again between public capital markets and private capital funds, which shows that ultimately these two ways of investing have boundaries that are not so well defined. In terms of, I would say, from a more macroeconomic and I would say financial policy perspective, I would say that securitization is welcome also, for instance, by the EU Financial Authority because of its ability to free up capital to be used for investment. But of course, it should be somehow regulated, and this is the reason, for instance, why the EU has adopted this securitization regulation that reduced the possibility of securitization, which introduced this risk retention rule. So again, the idea, the general idea also of a public institution is that securitization is in principle good, but it should be better regulated. Then just for sake of completeness, I have to say that many countries, like for instance Luxembourg, has of course securitization regulation directly applicable, but they have also a separate securitization law which still allows for more flexibility, including, for instance, the possibility to do securitization of securitization. But in these cases, the securitization vehicle that are not subject to EU regulation may have less benefits from other perspectives. So in conclusion, securitization is going to be important also in the next years. It will be super, it will be monitored, it will be regulated, as it is the trend for all the financial sector in the last years. And it's something that can benefit also real economy. So it's not just related to exotic financial operation, but it has a direct link, a direct impact on real economy, on industries, manufacturing, etc.
Thank you very much. I think that on behalf of my students, our students, on behalf of the Department of World Economy and the Faculty of International Economic Relations, I would like to say once more, thank you for very interesting and insightful lecture. Although there are many technical issues, but so the lecture was vivid and so the questions were quite interesting. So thank you very much, Dr. Barbieri. We would be happy to meet you and to host you at our university. So many thanks and good luck.
Thanks to you. Thanks a lot for the invitation, for the participation. It's always my pleasure. Thanks again.
So thank you and see you.
Thanks.
Bye.
Goodbye. Bye-bye.